out to all the globe heads out there.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the main event of the evening.
Where my FC Warriors at? The earth is flat. What you know about that? Waking up and realize 500 years of a lie. It's flat. A material plane. You got the balls on the brain. Heliocentric, insane. No matter how we rise, even up into the skies, the horizon hits your eyes. They told us it was a globe, just so they could control our mind, body, and soul.
Welcome to Flatter Than Other Hot Potatoes. I'm Mark Sargent, and joining us shortly will be your host, Patricia Steere.
Joining us now.
Hey, look at that.
Just like that, just like magic.
It is. Just like the globe. Just like magic. Yeah,
exactly. It's a fantasy world that we don't live in. Yeah. This is episode number 64 of Flatter Than Other Hot Potatoes, and let's talk about the song that we just played.
Yeah, it was the Earth is, oh crap, is the Earth is Flat, is that the actual name of the title?
The Earth is, oh crap, is not the name of the song.
No, it's not. It's something else. It's too
Flat
easy.
Earth Warriors by Rock Master.
Yeah, good song. And, it's on my Flatter short list. I highly recommend it. So
it's Rock Master, R-O-C-K-M-A-S-T-A Productions, and they need more subscribers. And I appreciate them allowing us to use that for our show today, which is cool.
Yeah. Yeah, right on. It's a good song. I like it.
I like it too. What's on that shirt you're wearing?
Oh, this is a this was sent to me by another Flat Earth listener, and this, you probably recognize it. Most people think it's the Gleason's map, Flat Earth map of the world, but actually it's the Beaumont's map.
What?
Which I think is the same thing. I think Gleason. Okay. I think Gleason and Beaumont were pretty much
They were just like this.
Yeah.
Best friends. No, I don't really know. I'll look it up to see if they're this one and the same. I have no idea.
So there you have it.
I do want to warn that my cats have been allowed to roam free. All three of them are out. They're still kittens until next month when they have their first birthday. And they're a little bit on the wild side still. They jump around and do things. One's trying to knock stuff over every we speak. I got these fake flowers, and they love them. I don't have them a display item, but I have them for them to play with. So my cats like to play with fake flowers.
You know what I use to play with a cat now?
Well, what you've got is better than anything.
I have the, I don't know the brand name, but it's a infrared thermometer, also a laser pointer. I don't know if you can see the laser. I'm not going to destroy the camera with it, but can you see the little red dot?
Yep, it looks yellow. Oh, now red.
Yeah. So... anyway,
well, what are you going to use that for? Playing with Bitsy your cat or something better?
I'm glad you asked, because anyone that's out there now, and I probably should bring it up now because it's getting dark on the East Coast already. It is a full moon tonight. So anyone that wants to go down to the hardware store, and by that I mean Lowe's or wherever they sell these things, you know, because they're all over the place, about $15, usually even come with batteries. And it's an infrared thermometer, and the test that I'm going to run is a moonlight temperature test. And you're probably saying to yourself, Mark, why run a moonlight temperature test? Why is this important to Flat Earth at all? Does it prove Flat Earth? No, it doesn't prove Flat Earth. But what it does is it creates some very, very interesting things to think about when it comes to the moon. Because Rob Skiba's done this, and San Jose has done this. Other people have done this, and the test. And I proved it last night, actually. I did a trial run, but I'm going to try to film it tonight, because tonight is the full moon. Get out there if you can. And that is that the moonlight is colder than the moon shade. Which is opposite. You're thinking, it doesn't make any sense, because we all know it's cold at night. It's like, yeah. But the sunlight, we all know if it's 100 degrees in the sun, it's 90 degrees or 80 degrees in the shade. But if you're in the moonlight, and let's say it's 50 degrees in the moonlight, it'll actually be 60 degrees in the moon shade. And that doesn't make any sense, because we all know that shade, it should be colder. And since the sun, mainstream science tells us that the moon reflects the sun's rays, it should be a little bit warmer in the moonlight, or at the very least neutral, and it is not. It is always colder. So the test I'm going to do tonight, and hopefully it'll film well, and I'll try to mix it in with Rob Skiba's video and the other one, is I'm going to do it with objects. You know, kind of what I mean there, and that is, I'm not going to use the street and just point over here and say, okay, you know, here's the moonlight and here's the moon shade. Just point on the ground, because that's not empirical test by any means. What you do is you take an object from the inside. In this case, I'm taking two metal mixing bowls, because metal conducts heat or cold very, very well, and I'm putting them on top of plastic containers so they don't actually touch the ground, so it doesn't get any temperature variation from the ground. And I'm putting one in the moonlight and one in the moonshade. But I'm gonna show them first, outside, you know, at the same place, so I can just hit it and go, okay, this one's 60 degrees, this one's 60 degrees. Then I put them in different places. I shoot them. They'll show the temperature differences, and then I'm gonna swap them. You know, people say, well, no, is that because that bowl was slightly bigger than the other bowl? No, I'm gonna swap them. I'm gonna do the same thing. So
sounds exciting.
I know.
I'm looking forward to it.
I'm very excited, because it raises some very big questions about the moon, things that we have missed over the years, that science has missed over the years. And until technology, I mean, who would know that these things have become so cheap, you know, $15 with a digital and Fahrenheit and Celsius, and comes with a little laser and a backlit thing so you can see it at night, that you can show that the moon is self-illuminated. That's what the test is really showing. And not only is it self-illuminated, but it's generating a completely different radiation from the sun, more like a cool laser. And I think it's really, really cool test. Does it prove the Earth is flat? No, but it raises some really, really interesting questions about the moon. I think even, and it's a really easy test to do. You don't even have to be near water to do it. And it's similar to the lunar waves shot by Crow 777, only much easier to find.
And that laser I ordered as well, and mine will be here tomorrow. I got mine on Amazon.
Did you order this one?
It's the same one, I think. It looked like that anyway.
The 1080 costs like $15. It was the best seller. Yeah.
Yes.
I do not even know who makes this. So it's not like we're endorsing a particular brand.
No, nor am I endorsing Amazon. Just that was an easy way to get it to my house.
I forgot to go through Jaren's channel.
Yes, go through Jaren's channel. And the way to do that is, well, you can go to the Jaronism webpage, and then he has these links. And one of those links is the direct link to Amazon. And I actually just took that and put it as a bookmark on my my page on my computer, so that I'll just go right to that in order to buy things from now on. I hadn't done that in the past. I forgot about it. And people are probably thinking, maybe some, oh, you guys are all connected and you're splitting a portion of the proceeds with Jaren. Well, the thing is, anybody can buy using that link of Jaren's. It just gives him a little bit of money. It doesn't cost you any extra money to purchase the item you want to purchase. And no, myself and Mark are not connected to any of Jaren's finances.
No, so we work for a very specific branch of the NSA, and we are not tied to the other guys at all. They got their own whole thing. Hey, let me show you this real quick.
Yes.
Because the because you're going
to
get this
we're
one.
We're connected to a very special branch that doesn't pay us. And
that's the worst branch. Our branch sucks.
It does.
You go through the training and it's like, all right, what's our field op going to be? And they go, oh yeah, you're doing this. You're not going to make any money. It's like, what? So I want to show you this, because you're going to have to do this on your side. And that is, the battery goes in here. So the handle, you see that.
Does it come with a battery?
Yes, it does. It comes with a 9-volt battery. And you've got to make sure, because to make sure the 9-volt battery doesn't touch any metal parts, they cover it with a thin film of plastic. Mm-hmm. And you don't know what's on there if you're not looking carefully at it. So you're trying to jam the connectors on this thing and it's not going over it. It's like, why isn't this working? So you got to take the battery out, take the little plastic cover off of the battery, and then put it in.
Got it.
And then you go. And you're.
It's one of those things where I put my glasses on to do that up close work. And yeah, I have 9-volt batteries anyway. What am I thinking?
Be careful with this.
Got a ton of batteries.
Be careful with this, because this is this is not a toy. It's got a laser thing on it. Do not shine it in your pet's eyes. Do not shine it in people's eyes. It's actually, the top part is a laser, just to kind of let you know what you're aiming at. Mm-hmm. And then that middle hole, and the big hole in the middle, that's what actually senses everything.
Okay.
But cats love this.
I was just going to say, it's safe to play with your cat with it as long as
you know. You just don't let your cats catch it. That's the thing. You don't ever shine it in your cat's eyes. And honestly, even if you lased yourself in the eye, it's not like you're going to go blind right away. I mean, it's low impact enough. Yeah, you might be a little disoriented, but it's just like anything.
Lased yourself. I don't know if that's actually a word, but I like it.
Lased yourself. Yeah. Yeah. In fact, honestly, you know, that because I've been kind of on an anti-science rant anyway, people forget that like LED bulbs, technically, and you can look this up on any flashlight, LED flashlights have been out for years and years. They're actually a low impact laser device. And you're not supposed to shine those in people's eyes either. But, you know, people keep forgetting that. Look that up. Any flashlight you buy nowadays, you look up, it's like, oh, yeah, by the way, LED is a, you know, they put a disclaimer in there, but nobody really talks about it. So anyway,
when I was really little, this is how weird I was. I had a flashlight by my bed. My sister and I, at one point when we were very young, shared the same bedroom. And I made sure that wasn't going on as very long as I got older, demanding my own bedroom. Yeah. But anyway, we had flashlights by our bed. I don't know why we did, but we did. They were fun kid flashlights. And I used to dare myself to take my flashlight and hold it, regular D battery flashlight probably, and hold it up and really close to my eye, each eye. I wonder if that did any damage to my eyes. I guess
I doubt it.
Probably not, because I've only had to wear glasses for reading as I got into my late 40s. So, but it used to freak my sister out. So she'd say, "You're gonna go blind," and I'm like, "Watch me!" You know, older sister, playfully torturing the 2-year younger sister.
Exactly, you're gonna go blind. That's usually reserved for other things, which we won't get into because this is a family show. Did you ever squint at the sun?
I always would. No, I mean, I was.
No, I mean, did you ever like
stare like all of us
directly look at the sun and go, "Hey, I can actually kind of make out a circle if I squint far enough."
Maybe, I don't know. Maybe, I mean, you know, there's these things they tell us, don't look at the sun. But we found out that sun gazing is actually beneficial to the human body. Number one, and number two, they probably tell us not to look at the sun because you'd be able to see what's really going on up there, or at least get a good idea about it.
Yeah, there you go.
So, I did want to mention something that's related to what you're talking about before we get to Q&A and have some emails.
Sure.
Got my phone here. You can see this light on my face. David Weiss put out a really good video today. You know what? Funnily enough, lately I could say that every single day because he just is a powerhouse of video production lately. He's become the new Flatwater, who also puts out a video all the time, it seems.
Yeah, David's putting out a lot of stuff.
Yeah. Okay, he put this one out today, and it is mirrored from an original video that he actually links. You can find this on his channel, Deep Inside the Rabbit Hole, DITRH. And it's the most recent video that he's put out. And the video is titled, "The Big Question, Are We Seeing the Sun in the Distance in This Video, Flat Earth?" And I'll just read the description. This is a video of a weather balloon shot at nighttime. You know how we always talk about that weather balloons not supposed to be shot up at night? Anyway.
Yeah. He showed me. He and I were comparing notes on this video this morning.
In the distance, we see what the creator of this video says is the moon. And David writes, "I don't know where and when this was filmed. However, it may not be the moon at all. Not knowing about perspective and atmospheric blocking of light could lead someone to automatically conclude it is the moon because from the point of the balloon, it's nighttime. But there are many different questions that he asks in the rest of this description, and watching the video is pretty neat. But the comment section is where we score some gold. A lot of great people in here, people I know, making some good comments here. Teresa Gordon, John Smith, Insanity is Sanity, a couple of people I don't know. You know, now, David is not saying 100% that it's the moon in this video, that it's the sun in this video, while the person who originally made the video believes it's the moon. But it is possible that indeed that is the case. And Arno Schilzon says, in the original description, this was a mission over Spain to study the stratosphere in 2016. And it was filmed on the 3rd and 4th of January, 2016. And then a couple other people replied to that and said that on that day, the moon would only have been 40% illuminated. And in this video that purports to show the moon, it's a full moon. That's why David and others are saying, that's no moon, that's the sun.
Which is really strange because it is not very bright from where it is, and it is not illuminating that much on top of it.
Yeah.
So the question is it going farther away? Yeah. People are going to have to take a look at that video because it's interesting. It's one of the few nighttime weather balloon shots we have so far. And funny, ironically, it was taken before the Flat Earth movement even happened.
Yes, and this video is on Deep Inside the Rabbit Hole, David Weiss's channel, and he links to the original and all that stuff I just mentioned is there and a whole lot more. You shooting that laser?
Nope.
You shooting me? What else should we touch on before we get to Q&A?
Mr. Sargent? Two things, I think, real quick. Let's get the one thing out of the way because people have mentioned it to me, and that was the rap video by Eric. I should mention it. I know you probably didn't want to bring it up, but I kind of want to because I still think Eric has a lot of talent and a lot to offer this movement.
He's a good actor, great comedy, and he's good at rap.
It's a good video. But the lyrics, I'm sorry, and I'll be as blunt as I can here. I just do not agree with his worldview that he wants to pick on Jewish people. And I would say that about anything. If he picked on black people, if he picked on homosexuals, if he picked on women, I would say that about anybody. You don't have to pick on a demographic to get your point across. Don't lump it in. You know how we've seen politicians lump in, you know, what they call it, writers on a bill. You know, you're trying to get a bill passed. So it's like, oh, yeah, I'll vote for this bill, but you got to include my special pork package for my state. Mm-hmm. That's what he does. It's like, oh, yeah, I'm a flat earth guy. Absolutely, I'm a flat earth. And I want to target this demographic. No, you don't. Just stick with flat earth. That's my argument.
And the thing is that anybody who's involved at all with exploring conspiracies has learned that there are people who are Jewish who are involved in some pretty bad things. But there's also people who are Christian, Catholic, Muslim. I mean, the list goes on. It's people.
The reason why, because I get emails sent to me every single week about, oh, you got to watch out for this group and this group. And the reason why I don't name them, I call them the authority, and I just name, you know, the government, the super rich and the royals, is because what group has the hierarchy here? Are we talking the Bilderbergers, the Rothschilds, the Illuminati, the Trilateral, the Jewish people, the Masons, the Jesuits? How many? We just keep going. It's like nobody knows the power structure. Nobody knows who's high on the totem pole here. I mean, everyone's got an idea, but there's no consensus on it. So that's why I don't bring them up. It's like, look, every man wants to rule the world. And are there exclusive clubs? Yeah, you bet there are. If you had several billion dollars, you'd start your own club too.
And there's probably really nice people who are Masons, really nice people who went to Jesuit schools. Yeah. They're just people. I mean, you know, Jesuit schools are all around. What if your parents put you in one? Does that make you a bad person, you know, there because you're a kid in Jesuit school? No, it depends what you do later, what kind of, how high up you rise in these groups and how you decide to take your life and if you decide to be one of the manipulators.
Ranking members of any group, and I don't care which one it is, generally don't know anything. You know, they're foot soldiers, like the military. The foot soldier doesn't know anything. They're just on the battlefield doing their job. No different than the people at NASA.
But some could say, why would you volunteer to be in the military when it's all about killing people? And so some would say, why would you volunteer to be in the Masons if you know all these other things? But the regular populace, the general public who's not involved in conspiracy, I don't think they think the Masons are bad at all. They have no idea.
No, I mean, at the lower levels, there's lots of different reasons why people join the military, some for economic reasons, some for national pride, some because your family did it. Mm-hmm. I mean, how many Army brats and Navy brats have I met over the years just because their dad did it? I mean, that's where the whole term came from.
Yeah, I got in radio because my dad did it. So
from what I could tell with the Masons, a lot of it had to do with business contacts. Well, no different than the Rotary or the Kiwanis Club or the Lions Club or any of those groups. They were all the same thing. And that was, once you were in, you got to rub elbows with other people in, you know, you got to make business contacts. It was the LinkedIn of the day. Let's put it this way. You got to be in rooms with people. It's like, oh, Joe owns a concrete company. Oh, he owns a construction company. He owns a law firm. And these guys would, you know, you swap.
It's business. Like a country club, actually.
Very much so. At that lower level. When you get to the higher level, it's, you know, you get to do more and more things. But at the lower levels, no, it's all business. It's all about money, like everything. So anyway, the Eric thing, enough said. It's a good video. I encourage people to watch it. But
good video, good rap, good talent, et cetera. But a lot of the earlier part of the video had a lot of kind of coarse vulgarity in it, as well as the Jew slamming bit. But people will say, oh, your mom was Jewish, and so you're a Jew. You're an Ashkenazi Jew, so that's why you would say something like that, okay? My mom was Jewish, converted before I was born. I know that means I still have Jewish blood on my mom's side. Never grew up practicing Judaism. That doesn't even matter. Even if I did, that'd be fine. It's who you are as a human being that matters.
Again,
why do I even need to say that?
My parting shots for that is that all he has to do is remove one video from his library on YouTube, and you know, he doesn't have to say sorry, just pull down the freaking video. And so many doors would open for him that he doesn't want. And it's like, all right, fine.
Well, I mean, he probably doesn't want whatever those doors are to open. He's happy with the doors that he's kicked open himself. So
The other thing I wanted to bring up was the, because we didn't do a recap since it's, I think it happened right after the show we did last time, was the debate, the actual Flat Earth debate.
Oh, which, on Dark City Radio.
Was that Dark? No, Dark 30.
Dark City.
Yeah, compared with dark, with darkness. I know. I'm doing a bunch of darks these days. Yeah. But that didn't come out right. I mean, Dark 30 Radio. It was supposed to be David Weiss and I against Richard Hoagland and Mark D'Antonio. Is that right?
And he's a guy, one of those MUFON UFO guys.
Yeah, yeah. He's a photographer. He's a photographic expert for UFO photos, which I'm not exactly sure if he tries to debunk or not, but he's heavy into the science. So I don't know if he believes it. I don't care. He does believe that we went to the moon, though. I know that. And we ran into a problem right away where Richard Hoagland was late and didn't call. And then they couldn't figure out what to do. So they said, well, this Mark guy's here. You know, not me, but the
Mark
other guy.
D'Antonio. Yeah. Let's just call him D'Antonio.
D'Antonio was there. So they say, without even telling me, they say, okay, look, we're going to bring you in, and they're announcing it on the air as I'm in there, which was like, okay, you're going to go one-on-one against D'Antonio. It's like, oh, okay. And David's sitting there on the outside, you know, he's messaging me. He's like, what's going on? I was going, I don't know. I got to talk to this guy. So this guy happened to be at a UFO convention, go figure. And he had friends over his shoulder, and they were laughing and having fun at my expense. And so I probably wasn't as composed as I should have been.
Well, the thing is that if you decide to go into a debate, any sort of debate on any sort of topic, and you yourself are ready to go, and you got your information, and you and David were like that, and then the person that you're going to be debating against is in a very loud public room with friends, you know, at a social event, and you can kind of hear that social event atmosphere going on and yelling out things like, ask them about the curvature, you know, or whatever it is. Uh-huh. People yelling, men and women in the background, and then laughing. It throws off the whole debate. And I think the fault is not as much with D'Antonio, who probably should have been better behaved in a debate, but it's with the moderator of Dark 30 Radio. And if you're the person who's the one who's conducting a show where there's supposed to be a debate, you've got to tell the individuals involved on either side of the debate the rules and stick with the rules. And so we really haven't had a real flat earth debate yet. I mean, you did the thing with Stanton Friedman with Chris Centuri Geo, and that was really good, but it wasn't a debate, you know, so we can't even really count that. It was nice to listen to. And then this one wasn't really a debate either. It was kind of a mess.
It was a mess. I mean, I did what I could with the guy, and he ended up quitting, which was fantastic. You know, he almost quit in the first 5 seconds, but
that's true. He was supposed to be there for the length of the program, but after one segment,
one round, it was over. Yeah, he had nothing. He knew that too. And then Richard Hoagland never called in. So they brought in Brian. What was his name? Brian. Can't remember his name either. And he seemed, you know, he was very calm and he stayed for the duration of the show. And then we find out later, and he was he runs the Skeptoid.
The
Skeptoid website.
Look up his last name.
Yeah, look up his last name. And then it turns out somebody sent me a link like almost immediately after listening to the interview. It's like, who's this Brian guy? And the reason why he did the show is because he had nothing to lose, because the Skeptoid, Brian, who spent his living writing books about exposing fraud and conspiracies, was actually convicted and went to prison for fraud, where he stole money from eBay. And it took him 6 years for the litigation to finally come to a conclusion. And he just did time. 15 months, I think, and then just got out. He's on parole right now.
Yeah, Brian Dunning, actually.
Brian Dunning, yeah.
15 months in prison for fraud.
For fraud, where he stole we can't figure out exactly, that was part of the problem, how much money he took from. He owned a company, or was part owner in a company that did business with eBay, and then he cooked the books, admitted to it, went to prison, and got out. Now he's kind of looking to get back into the whole conspiracy world. So I'm probably not going to be debating that guy again, because I'm sorry, if you're, it's one thing if you're arrested, you know, honestly, he would have been better off being arrested for assault than being arrested for fraud. You know, that means you're lying, you know, for lying big time, basically. So
now I have heard people say, well, Mark Sargent's convicted criminal too.
Yes.
Indeed you are.
I am.
How can I even be friends with you? I'm shutting the show down.
That's it. We're out of here. No. I was in college one, and it was a fireworks company too. I was making illegal fireworks for the Native American reservations that were in the area. So,
and so what happens? Police came, looked for you, scared your mom out of her wits.
Yeah.
Found you.
Didn't find me because I was 100 miles away. But yeah, it was.
Did you do hard time? Were you breaking rocks in the hot sun?
No, I was freaking. What was I? I was 20, I think, when I was indicted. So no.
What happened? No. Did you get a slap on the wrist? Did you?
Yes, I got a slap. You know the story. I got a slap on the wrist. If anyone wants to hear it, anyone wants to hear the story of what happened to me, my very first Strange World episode, because I believe in transparency, shill or not. So it's on. Look up Strange World episode one. It's my whole fireworks story.
I remember before I met you, listening to that and liking the story.
Painstaking detail. No, it was a fun story. I'd still do it again. What I try to tell people is like, look, if you aren't getting into trouble in college, then you're not trying or not trying hard enough, because there's a time and a place for everything. And that place is college.
So, nobody was scammed, ripped off.
No, nobody was ripped off. Everybody got paid. That was the best.
Nobody was hurt by fireworks, right?
No, not by my stuff. Nobody was hurt by my stuff. And in fact, everyone that was involved in the project, I pretty much still had communications with.
Why is there the law against it? Why is it considered bad? We all know why scamming and skimming money laundering and all that, like the Brian guy did, is bad. Why is this bad?
It didn't used to be. I was just born in the wrong era. It was part fireworks became the heavy duty fireworks, and any guy out there knows what I'm talking about. You know, big firecrackers, M80s, M100s, half sticks, cherry bombs, that sort of stuff. That became illegal during the Child Protection Act that Kennedy signed in the 1960s. And the reason was, we used to, go off on a quick tangent here. The United States used to make big fireworks domestically. We didn't get them from China. We made them here. After the Civil War, all the munitions factories converted over, well, several of them anyway, converted over to fireworks factories. And the problem is that fuses for these things, they're really tough during the daylight, like in direct sunlight, to see if they're lit or not. So you can imagine, you got teenage kids, you know, they light it. They're not sure if it's lit. It's like, you want to check it? Yeah, I should check it. So they walk up to it, boom, and then somebody loses a finger or whatever. And so that's why it's part of the Child Protection Act. Let's have less hospital visits for kids. And so they made them illegal. But unfortunately, you know, Americans love their 4th of July stuff. And so the illegal market immediately came in and people had to make them, you know, the cherry bombs, the M80s and all that stuff. And so I volunteered to make them at college. So probably not my best move, but I don't regret. I'd do it again. Absolutely would do it again. If I had a time travel machine and had to go back and do it again, I absolutely would do it again.
Sounds fun.
It was fun. So,
all right. What do you think? Emails first, Q&A. I vote for Q&A. What do you think?
Let's do Q&A. Let's jump back and forth. But before that, real quick, the debate. If anyone wants to listen to the debate I had on Dark 30, just go to my channel, Mark K. Sargent, and it's I can't remember what interview it is. If it's 60, I think it's 60. But it doesn't matter. You just look at it. It'll be Dark 30 Radio, and it'll say debate. I put debate in all caps because I know I don't do a lot of debates. So this one was kind of fun. So you'll enjoy it. The first, I enjoyed doing it. So anyway, let's go to Q&A, shall we?
I enjoyed listening to it, and I was on hold the whole time because I wanted to. They were taking calls, and I was hoping that they would take my call. And
because they kept asking, where are the women in the conspiracy
world? That's why I'm like, well, I'm going to call in. And so I called in, and I was on hold so long that I got bored, and I hung up. And immediately after that, I heard the host say, I think David Weiss mentioned my name. And then the host said, oh, she was just on hold but hung up.
So I guess the caller ID. Got bored? Really?
No, I just was tired of being on hold. I wanted to think, whatever.
I'm tired of looking at this scenery. Let's have it moved.
No, I was on hold for maybe 30 minutes. It's too long.
What do you mean that mountain can't be moved? get somebody on that. Anyway, let's go to
the Q&A here on Flat Earth and Other Hot Potatoes. Oh, Jeffrey Grupp is my guest tomorrow at 10 p.m. Central Time. Somewhat late for a show for me, but it's due to his familial situation. He doesn't, his kids around in noise, so he can only do a show at a later time than my usual 5 p.m. So it's Jeffrey Grupp talking sun dogs, maps, Flat Earth, and more tomorrow, February 23rd, 2016, at 10 p.m. Central Time.
Biggest brain in Flat Earth.
You always say that.
He does, because he has a huge cranium. Have you seen his head? Seriously, I have a size 8 hat.
Okay, he does have a large head.
He has a big head.
Does that mean his brain is big?
Yes, it does.
Really?
If the engine compartment is big, there's probably a big engine in it. Just saying.
All right. Let's go right to Jordan Rain's question. It seems to pop up first, and I don't even know the answer to this. The first question, I have no idea. Maybe you do. Question from Jordan Rain's is, Patricia, what do you and Mark think about that creepy Russian Pope going to Antarctica?
Creepy Russian Pope?
So the Pope is in Antarctica?
No, not the current one. Pope Francis, he's not Russian, is he?
Question must be rephrased because I don't get it. I'm looking through because sometimes other people see the question and then comment on
it. Yeah, you got to get a link or something. Yeah, be a little more detailed. Or say, did you know? You're right. You know what? You're right, because sometimes we know the story and sometimes we don't. But I looked through a lot of the news stuff today and I didn't see it. The Pope wouldn't be going down to Antarctica, would he?
Here's somebody else about it. Eliza Sofa Spoon says, I didn't hear about a Russian Pope, Jordan. So it's not just me that's confused.
That's right. We'll come back. We'll come back to it.
Back to that one. John White writes, seems like you could make a better case by using video support versus just showing yourselves talking. Thanks. Video support to what?
Video support of what? You mean like sharing screens and showing?
Not that kind of show.
Not that kind of show.
But thank you. And if indeed I needed to show something specifically, well, maybe the person is meaning that I could have shown David Weiss's video.
And if, I mean, I'm, given I am more motivated than she is because I'm more monstrous, you know, and don't like to be on video. The bells. But Patricia, why don't you want to look at Patricia? She's eye candy.
No.
I'm just not saying.
But yeah,
that's what her daughter says anyway.
What daughter? Oh, that's a funny story.
Croatian girl.
Yes, there's a rumor in Flat Earth World, a crazy rumor. One guy is spreading it and it's crazy.
It's
that the Croatian girl is actually, okay, that Mark and I are secretly married, which is untrue. And our daughter is the Croatian girl.
Yeah, our daughter is the Croatian girl. So. And we apparently sent her to a Ukrainian boarding school.
Well, I don't know, because why does she have that accent and we don't?
She's studying to be a Russian spy.
Yes. And the thing about that kind of a strange sort of rumor like that is, my question is, why?
Exactly.
If you and I were married, we'd just do a show in the same room together like Chris and Cherie Gio. It would be no problem.
Yeah. But you're in Houston and I'm up here near Seattle. Yeah.
If we were even in the same state, exactly. I would be there with you or you'd be here with me in the same room at least some of the time.
Unless it's part of a greater plot.
Right. That's the thing. Explain to me what the greater plot could be that we would be married but pretend we're not and have this daughter who goes by the name the Croatian girl who actually speaks about her father in her videos who turned her on to conspiracies.
Yeah, the father is not me.
Who first discovered conspiracies through Mark Sargent's videos. The whole thing's weird. So
proud of my Croatian daughter.
She'd be a great daughter to have. I mean, smart girl. Really cool. So,
our marriage is not recognized in the States.
She is my daughter, but I have no responsibility for her. I send away. I send away the daughter.
I send away.
Worst act ever.
Disrespectful child.
Anyway.
Yes,
indeed, there is some validity to, as John White said, to maybe showing David Weiss's video as opposed to just talking.
Oh, right. Well, no, because they just go to it. You don't have to.
Yeah.
No,
I'm encouraging people to go visit the video.
Yeah, because it's not going to do it justice just to show the video. Plus, we'd have to be commenting over the video. No, it's not that kind of show.
Yeah, but on some shows, it's a good idea to do that.
Yeah.
I did a show with David Weiss last night.
And this is and live. We were doing editing after the fact. Yes, of course we would. Yes. But it's live. You're watching it live, man. Embrace the liveness.
I hope. Next question from Teresa Gordon, who writes, hope this makes sense. Well, looking at many maps, especially the azimuthal projection, I notice semicircular sand tracks in North Africa and Asia following the sun. The Americas have those same tracks on the West Coast. Maybe it can help with mapping. Do you know what she speaks of?
No.
I don't.
I do not.
Man, that's too...
I want to bring up, but that reminded me of something, and that was part of the debate. You remember that part, Brian, what was his name? Brian?
Dunning.
Okay, I can remember that. Brian Dunning, the criminal. Do you remember when he said...
He was a really nice guy, though, apparently.
I didn't actually say criminal. That was a subliminal message, and I don't put hot sex messages like that into my... my sentences. But no, what I was going to say was, wasn't that very interesting though, when he got to that point where from a scientific standpoint, I don't know what he's a scientist of, where he said that, you know, science has a real problem in that, because I asked him that question is like, look, if you're a scientist and you have to grab the average person on the street with an IQ, whatever, and you have to show them, you know, you have to prove to them it's a globe, how would you do it? And he goes, there's the problem. You can't do it from the ground. I mean, yeah, you can quote math at them all along, but that's not proof. You know, that's just math. How would you prove it? He goes, I'd have to give them $20 million and put them up in a rocket. And my argument...
Then they would just blow up and die as the rocket came back down to Earth.
But the point was, is that, okay, which means that everything, the only way to prove it, which is, you know, why the argument is you've been told this, you don't know this, anything about space or the planets or anything, you've told this, is that every bit of information that the scientists hold as proof is being held by the gatekeepers that run the sky. And that means the space agencies. And, you know, at that point, it's like, okay, show us the proof, space agency. And there, you know, at that point, there should be tons and tons and tons of evidence. And there's not. And so he realizes that's why the playing field, and I know when I say leveling out, that kind of, it's playing words. But it is, the playing field becomes a lot more level because science doesn't have any, yeah, they'll say that flat Earth doesn't either, but science doesn't really have anything on the ground either. So, and it shouldn't be like that. You know what I mean? It science should be way up here without. They should be there and they're not. So,
all right.
Anyway, sorry, that was my little thing. Go.
All right. Next question on Q&A on the show is, wouldn't it be easy to prove the moon is flat by using two people on opposite sides of the plane where they both see the moon? Shouldn't the person on the left see the left side of the roundness and same with the right side, but that's not what we see. That's Chev's 911 truth.
Yeah.
There's so many different ways to look at it.
Yeah, I'm kind of mixed on the whole thing anyway. One of the guys that called into Brian Dunning is that...
You've got a block against his name. You've got a mental block.
I do. I'm sorry. I actually like talking to him. But then I found out, I was like, the only reason he was on the show is because he's trying to rebuild his reputation.
Jesse Spots and I were... chatting among ourselves, you know, as we were both listening to the debate live, and we were both like, that Brian guy's pretty cool. He might become a flat earther. And then later, he may be pretty cool, but
yeah, but there's nothing. I'm sorry. There's nothing. Look, if you're
convicted, you've swindled people out of their money, you can't really trust them.
Yeah. And you're a skeptic. I mean, your whole thing is based on integrity and not doing a fraud of your own. That doesn't matter. But one of the guys that called him was saying that, yeah, you know, if the moon is, from a photography standpoint, if the sun is shining on it during a full moon, it shouldn't be uniformly lit on all sides. There should be a drop off. There's been a couple of videos out recently where the light should start to drop off on the edges as it's starting to bleed around it. It shouldn't be uniformly lit. And he goes, look, there's so many pictures where it looks uniformly lit. Like if you think I'm joking, look at the kids' toys, because you can get this for children's bedrooms where you hang a flat moon on your wall, you hit the light, and it looks eerily like the one we see in the sky. The only difference is that's backlit. So how can that thing be so easily backlit and look identical to the one that's in the sky? It shouldn't look like that.
Yeah,
not because the one you hang on your wall is flat. So
It's anyway, flat, just like your license plate behind you.
Oh,
on
right.
Your monitor.
Washington, it's flat, Evergreen State. That's the dedication. I'm trying to avoid the word committed. It's like, that's how committed, because it's too easy, right? It's like, I'm committed to the flat earth, and people are going, oh, you're committed, all right.
Oh, you're committed.
Oh, yeah. But no, that's how dedicated I am. I'm driving around with this thing, and yeah, it's flat, and you helped me pick it.
I'm going to be getting one too, eventually.
So did our daughter when we bring her back from her exile in Mother Russia.
No, she's in Croatia.
Oh, whatever.
Get the fake story right.
Right. Croatia. We couldn't afford Russia. We had to send her to Croatia.
Moscow too expensive.
She.
Anytime I try to do an accent that's Russian, it just sounds like I'm from Transylvania. I sound like Dracula's mom.
You got to drag out your S's without sounding gay.
Okay.
If that's possible. It's no good.
Jimmy Roberts writes, I predict Mark and Patricia and others will someday be on the national network media because the shadow government needs it to come out. What do you think about that?
I agree.
What do you mean that they'll just interview varying people? Sure they will. Maybe if this goes mainstream.
No, that we're shills. We should come out of the closet right now because of that question. No, I'm totally kidding. Because you're right. It is, and that guy that wrote the question, he knows it's part of a bigger picture. And I always suspected it was part of a bigger picture because.
But I don't understand what he means. Does he mean that someday some people in Flat Earth, and he named us and others, are going to be on mainstream media?
Will probably be used as pawns to
what?
Help. To
Wait
help
a minute. Really. I didn't sign up for that.
Well, no.
I don't want to be used as a pawn.
It's not your decision. You can use me, but not my daughter. I mean, that's what they would try to do because you want to use assets on the ground if you can. Use the assets that are there for you. You know how it goes. Look, if you're going to release this thing, because what he's saying there is very, very true. And we all know this. Anybody in the conspiracy world knows this. And that is, if you see it on mainstream, there's an ulterior motive. Plain and simple. If it is on, and if it's on every mainstream media, then you know absolutely 100%. I mean, it's like power corrupts and absolute power corrupts absolutely. I mean, the Flat Earth story between the BOB and Neil deGrasse Tyson thing, when that thing came out, everybody, I mean, from Time Magazine to NPR to Wall Street to Esquire Magazine to MTV, they all covered it. And it was... If you see it on everything, then what are you going to do? I mean, it's mainstream. Hang on one second. Hold that thought.
Oh, hold that thought.
I'm still talking.
Okay.
I gotta shut this window.
I thought you were leaving the building or something.
No.
Bathroom break? What's going on?
The law enforcement is here. Cannot talk
Act
much
natural.
Longer. I am an American citizen.
Poor Croatian girl. This is all because of her.
I know.
And this one guy, if you've just joined us, a YouTuber who has decided that Mark and I are secret married and Croatian girl is our daughter, just for no apparent reason.
I demand embassy. I mean, aside, whatever. So, what he's saying is that if it's part of a bigger plan, and it is going to be part of a bigger plan. The question is, will any flat earthers be drug into it somehow? It's possible. I mean, I said I won't flip. So can they use us for something and still keep us in, you know, kind of ignorant? You know, in ignorant.
Okay, give me an example of where you, I, or others in Flat Earth could be used to help the mainstream.
Oh, they would use our message and amplify it in the mainstream.
Why is that bad? Then more people would get to know it.
Well, it's not bad. It's not bad, but could they use it for something more sinister? Possibly.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Where they use Flat Earth and then turn it into
terrorism. You mean like that?
Well, no, because that's the bad side. I mean, you still could do that. I mean, you could write, you know, you'd take a white van and put it next to something and write Jaronism's name on it and blow it up. Not saying you should do that. And then blame it on flat Earth and turn flat Earth in. Because if you take the dark way, then flat Earth can be turned into one of two things. One is, of course, you try to push it into the religious cult aspect, which they've been kind of, you know, hinting here and there at with the... I remember how they took my one interview and kind of took it out of context, where I said it's turning into a new religion, and you could turn it into that, or you could turn it into link it up with something with ISIS or something ridiculous, but turn it into something dangerous. Because remember Neil deGrasse Tyson, when he was on television, no accident there, because that was scripted, he said that he considers the whole concept very dangerous to our civilization. He didn't go much more into it, but he could elaborate. That's a good building block for him to go off of. So maybe. We'll see. But yeah, do I think it's part of a bigger picture? Yes. Do I know exactly what that bigger picture is? No, because there's different roads you could take. I'm hoping they take the high road and turn it into something good. We'll see.
So me
just
too.
Be aware. If you're in flat Earth, just be aware. Look, Tyre Dan is gone. I don't know what happened to him, but, you know.
Comments occasionally, I see.
Well, as far as you know.
As far as I know, that's him. Okay, well.
Is it him? We don't know. He hasn't shown his face or done anything audio.
Learned of the Jesuit order, took down all of his videos, and then he came back and did another video, but not with the ISS. He's just doing a NASA exposure video. So maybe indeed he just felt that his ISS material wasn't completely provable and
or
is
they
still
didn't.
Continuing exposing NASA.
Or they didn't come through with the payment.
Mm.
You know, if they said, look, we'll pay you. All you have to do is take down your channels, like right on. And he didn't sign anything. Not that you could sign anything anyway. And then it's like, he's waiting. Nothing happened. He's like, damn it. They screwed me. And he didn't have backups for anything. So he has to start over from scratch.
Nice story, but I kind of think it's the other. I definitely think, because he's just still not touching the ISS. But the whole thing is weird anyway.
Yeah. Anyway, flat earthers, just be careful out there, because you could be used for potentially for something bad. Again, I don't blame you. I told David Weiss, I said, look, take the money. If they offer it to you, take the money. You've got a family, a wife, and stuff like that. I don't. I've never been married or have kids. I got nothing to lose. So
he's got a girlfriend. What do you mean take the money? Like if somebody offered David Weiss money to quit doing Flat Earth?
Yeah, take it.
He wouldn't do that.
I'm just saying, don't. Integrity is one thing, and everyone says, no, I'd never sell out. It's like, well, lots of people would. So don't, I'm not going to,
because would sell out if indeed their family, the lives of somebody in their family were, at risk.
That's why, again, you always offer the carrot and the stick at the same time. And that is, here's a briefcase of money and here's the gun. You choose which one we're going to open, you know, and so it's tough for some people to,
oh, this is scary and dark.
Sorry.
Well,
sorry. Anyway, let's go to a happier question.
All right, let's do that.
Let's do that. And by the way, speaking of happy, I liked Orphan Red's last video. Where she was dressed in a black shirt and was talking about positive things.
Oh, yes.
About positive things that go along with flat Earth.
Yes. She also did a great interview with Nathan Oakley.
That went well.
Yeah, really good.
Yeah, it was good. And I didn't see any hate in Nathan's girlfriend at all.
Nathan's girlfriend was just like super cool and sitting there smiling right next
she
to
was.
Nathan the whole time.
She was. I think her nails were probably dug into Nathan's leg though.
No.
Probably.
She's just as...
You're not interviewing Orphan Red. Not alone, you're not.
No.
I'm sorry, Nathan. You know I'm kidding. But I'm not. I'm not real.
You mean Nathan, not David. Okay. Next question.
Nathan. I said Nathan.
I thought you said David. Sorry.
No, Nathan Oakley. Nathan David. Okay. Sorry.
Yeah, you know.
Yeah.
Any random guy's name.
Guy's name. All right. What else we got?
Raven Lux writes, hello, everyone. Don't forget that YouTuber CEEDEE caught the lunar wave twice.
Yeah, that was a good one. Yeah, it came from the, if you look at it from a north, south, east, west facing you, it was coming from the southeast corner. And it was
really
weird.
Usually it comes from the bottom up, right?
Well, it does. It does, but it came. Yeah, but it. But with Crow 777s, it was coming from a different direction. I'm sorry, it's reversed how you guys are looking at me. With Crow 777, it was coming this way, and this one was coming this way. And it was really interesting. Yeah, take a look at that. That was
when
really,
did
really
this cool. video come out?
A few days ago.
Why did I miss that?
I don't know. You sent me stuff that I miss.
Yeah, I guess it happens.
That
so
thing
much.
You sent me today, and I was like, and it was from what, 4 days ago or yeah. No, I'm sorry. It was from 3 weeks ago.
Exactly.
I was like, what happened? How did we do miss stuff every once in a while.
Right.
But not often.
All right. I will look at CD's video.
Yeah.
And I am going to be interviewing Crow 777, and it may be on this show or it may be on another show with David Weiss called Truth is Stranger Than Lies. I really don't know at this point. Masquerade writes, do you think the enlightened ones, parentheses, Freemasons, are jealous or even envious of flat earthers because we talk freely about the flat earth? And writes, love your show.
Maybe at the highest level, unless it was part of the plan to begin with. I mean, it was obvious that the Masons were supposed to keep part of the secret, you know, and that was one of the big ones. If anyone has any doubt, look at the five tracing boards. Which I talked about in several different shows. You can look
You've
them
got
up.
Them. You can see them on one of your Strange World episodes as well.
Yeah, yeah. It's not a big secret. So I don't know if they're mad or anything, because I think it was supposed to come out eventually. I think it was part of the natural process where we were supposed to figure this thing out, and it was hidden eventually. It was delayed. So I think we were supposed to figure it out maybe no later than the late 70s or early 80s. And it's been dragged out. It's 2016. And now finally it's starting to come forward. Or was that part of the plan the entire time? Did you need social media? Did you need high speed internet and smartphones and everything else to where everyone's interconnected so that when it comes out, everyone's got the story straight? You don't really have to spin anything because you can shoot it live. You can stream it live everywhere. Simultaneous.
This never would have happened if it weren't for YouTube. That's how I found out about all of the stuff me eventually to Flat Earth.
Could this thing have even happened? Well, the movement obviously wouldn't have happened. But even without, the concept could have never spread as fast as it, or at all, without high-speed internet and a place to store it. You know, a big cloud. I mean, yeah, it's YouTube, but really it's just a big video cloud storage. It arose by any other name. So whatever, if it wasn't YouTube, it would have been something else.
I like the song we played at the very beginning of this episode and how he says something along the lines of, hey, all you FE warriors. I'm like, yeah.
Yeah.
You know, we're not really warriors. We're not, but we are really in a way. I mean,
yeah, I know we're in a fight, but it's not a knockdown, dragdown fight, because eventually the people, because we it's different from your normal. I know he interspliced scenes from 300, the movie.
Mm-hmm. I love that movie, by the way, which is a very great. Most women aren't.
Yeah, it's
movie.
A real guy movie. In fact, I think that movie replaced Apocalypse Now as one of those movies you use to get troops charged up. Mm. Even though it's ancient times, it's still relevant to the whole bloodlust thing. But anyway, where is it going with this? He interspliced the fighting scenes from 300, but he didn't. But that's not how the fight goes. The fight is really you're hitting somebody, and then finally they go, hey, you know what? I totally agree with you. I don't have to fight anymore. And then they join you.
That's it.
And then you go off to beat up somebody else.
Yeah, it's hitting people with information and doing it, I, from my opinion anyway, in a very positive way until they just suddenly say, wait, what? Hey, you're right. down their, you know, weapon, whatever they've been using to fight you.
I'm going to use an Orphan Red reference, and that is, even though she didn't say this, I think of her. It's like you're hitting them with a big unicorn pillow covered in glitter. And it's just, you know, there's glitter everywhere. They're like, stop it. It's like, hey, I totally get this. You know, it's like, give me a pillow.
The sparkle sounds.
The sparkle sounds. That's really what it's like, because it is positive. I mean, I added tracks 70. My music list is getting pretty big. I mean, I've got in my Flat Earth music list on my channel, I've got, 70 tracks now? And covering a wide range of genres, we could do several double albums. I know people don't say that anymore, but you could. You could do, you know, remember like those double live albums were really, really huge.
With the gatefold, I actually got behind me as well. So
there you go. The We've got a lot of music. What other conspiracy has music? And it's not like even half of, I mean, maybe a tenth of the tracks are kind of dark and brooding. The rest are really positive.
And the dark and brooding stuff is good too, because there's that aspect to this, because we've been lied to. That's not pretty.
Do you know a lot of country songs that are made about 9/11 or Pearl Harbor or JFK?
There is a country song about 9/11 about losing a wounded, you know, or a wounded warrior.
Yeah, that's different though. That's different though. If you're combining the troops, that's a whole nother thing. You're not going to hear a country song going, "Hey, the buildings fell, and lots of rubble." You know, you're not going to see that.
Where did the towers go? Boy, there's a lot of accents going on in this show. The fake Russian accent, the fake Ukrainian accent, and the fake
country. Yeah.
Let's get back to Flat Earth.
Back to Flat Earth.
Question here from Tedward P. I believe there is a dome and there is no space. I did more research on what UFOs are, and they all seem to be demons, fallen angels. And the reason why the globe Earth came to be 500 years ago was to discredit God. And then they created science and this new age movement. Right on with that.
Yeah. I'm with that. Yeah. And again, Robin, why does there have to be space? Why? If you can fake space, you don't need it. Just saying.
Yeah. It all makes sense once you start thinking about it.
You're Robin picking up what I'm
Poe
putting down.
Writes, indeed I am. Robin Poe writes, how can we encourage people to make more videos? Well, we did the Flatties. That was a way to encourage people to make more videos.
Yeah. You don't have to, because it happens. It's been happening. It's been happening. And that is, people get so worked up. They either get real inspired for the Flat Earth the second they see it, and they see that people are making videos, it's like, I can make one of those. Or they get real angry on the other side. It's like, I'm going to give these Flat Earthers a piece of my mind. I've never used this phone before. I'm going to make a video. That's what they do. It's like, people, how many channels have you and I seen? Or like brand new channels, you know, brand new people are using YouTube for the first time, obviously made like their first, they don't know how to edit, their sound's terrible. It's just, you know, the phone's all over the place. So you don't have to worry about people making new videos. I mean, look at the video count. What is it today? Still 4.7 million?
Yeah, we haven't reached 5 yet, but
why not 5? Maybe that's part of the trigger.
I was attempting to take a screen capture of when my subscriptions reached
6666.
Yeah. 6. But I missed out.
Four sixes, yeah.
Right. Darn. Missed out.
Yeah, I know. And then I was going to make a meme of it. No. The devil robot queen.
Next question from John. I'm skipping over that. that never happened. John White wrote, Mark, what do you think would happen using a Fresnel lens to concentrate moonlight?
Fresnel lens?
Fresnel lens.
Is there another name for it?
Maybe there is.
Other than a magnifying glass?
What's a flat lens? And it's made of concentric rings, and it reduces the appearance of a sphere, something like that.
If there was
a lens that did that to concentrate moonlight, how would that? I don't know how that would work.
I mean, right now we're already seeing that concentrated moonlight is colder. So if you have another lens that can concentrate even further, hey, great, wonderful. The biggest range we're seeing right now, at least the ones that Rob Skiba is reporting, is if the moon is high enough. Because like when I'm testing it tonight, it's going to be almost like a 45, 50 degree angle, which I'm not going to get, you know, super direct. But we're getting temperature variances of 12 to 13 degrees. Between moonlight and moonshade. So, you know, could we crank another 5-6 degrees out of it? Maybe we'll see. But yeah, I'm still, once you see videos like that, forward them off to professors. Say, explain this somehow. Explain how radiation is being transmuted from heat to, what was even the word for it? Refrigerant? Tell me how that happens. Doesn't
happen. The lens is used in photography, and there are various pronunciations: Fresnel, Fresnel, Fresnel. So those in the know, you pick the pronunciation that you like best.
Somebody has access to one of these great lenses. Use it if you can.
Yeah.
So.
All right, here we go with our next question on Q&A on Flat Earth and other accents.
Other accents. Yep.
We've got to do one more different accent during
the show. Oh, man. I don't know what I'm going to do.
I've covered all the ones I know. And they're bad.
So. All right. Well, I'll come up with something. So
okay. Mr. Rich B.O.V. says, I watched a sermon by Jesse Duplantis, and he said the perfect thing to attribute to Flat Earth is, quote, spectacular things bring glory to men, but supernatural things bring glory to God. I say we should make up our minds. It was a close encounters of the God kind moment.
Hmm.
That's kind of neat.
That is kind of neat. Again, you know, it's something I'm going to come at science with if I ever get to sit down with a scientist and say, if science found proof of intelligent design, would they keep it from the people? And it's like, well, considering that intelligent design hurts science, yeah, absolutely.
Yes, they would. Indeed they would.
You bet they would. They're not going to shoot.
In my opinion.
Yeah, I mean the thing for the remember Indiana Jones when they just crated up the Ark of the Covenant and put it in a box. Yeah, that's exactly what they would do, because the Ark of the Covenant cannot exist in the society that
all those books that may prove things about things we don't even know what those books are supposedly are locked up in the Vatican.
Yeah,
somewhere.
Yeah.
That could shed light on so many different things.
Yeah, which is why Flat Earth is the all in one kill shot.
It's the kill shot.
Yep. Kill shot.
And we're standing on the corpse, which is the Flat Earth.
She's not dark, folks, really.
No, I don't mean it that way. I just mean that the evidence is right beneath our feet. The evidence is right there.
She's going to be working on poison apples next.
Lee Belt writes, how much difference does air temperature affect the shadow temperature, do you think, Mark?
Affect the shadow temperature? I don't know much at all, because the when we're pointing at objects, we're pointing at the actual object itself. It's not, I don't think it's, I think this gun is compensating for whatever it's pinpointing the temperature. So whatever it's punching through, I don't think it cares, because it's basing it off the reflection of the target.
Okay.
If that makes sense. It shouldn't. I mean, besides, you put an object out in the air temperature, let's say the air temperature is 30 degrees, the object should be 30 degrees.
Right, exactly.
That if it sits sense. Out there long enough.
Room temperature, pretty much. Or
it's the Stephen Wright joke. It doesn't matter what the temperature of the room is, because it's always room temperature.
I love Stephen Wright. Love that kind of humor.
Room temperature, by the way, used to be 72 degrees. Now it's 68.
You know, it's so true. When I go into buildings, and I live currently in Houston, Texas, and before this lived in New Orleans, Louisiana. And in these places where it's very hot during the spring and summertime, and even the fall before they change the temperature, the thermometer, it's freezing in buildings. You go in a building or in a restaurant or something like that, and it's ice cold. Room temperature now is quite cold. What a waste of electricity.
I know you're not old enough to remember, because you're only like 29, but the which meant she had a Croatian girl when she was very young. which is typical in Russia. I remember the TV and newspaper announcements when they changed the room temperature from 72 to 68, and when they told people to start taking showers and not baths to save water. People used to take baths. People didn't take showers that much. I mean, a lot of Americans took baths instead of showers, and nobody does that anymore. People only take baths. In fact, when does anybody take a bath?
Yeah, I took a bath somewhat recently because I was feeling sick and wanted to clear my sinuses.
That's
super
different.
Rare occurrence for me. Wait, to me, it seems like bathing in your own dirt.
Filling up bathing in your
own Well, you are. Dirt. When I was a little girl, you know, your parents gave you baths. That's what happens when you're a child.
Pay no attention to her, folks. She fills up the bathtub with oils like and frankincense and myrrh and flecks of gold.
I did use some really nice stuff in the bath.
Of course you did.
But I don't, I'm not into baths, really.
No.
Therapeutic baths, yes. Bath on an everyday basis, no.
So the point was people used to take baths.
Yes, indeed.
Even when showers were around, they didn't take baths.
I once met this person, and I went to his house. This was in the 90s, and he was showing me around his house. And he had a stand-up shower, and he had a bathtub. Yeah. And then I saw them both just briefly during the house tour. And then at one point later, I was talking to him on the phone, and he said, I got to go. I'm going to take a bath. And I said, that's weird. Generally, these days, people take showers. you know, especially women may take baths with candles and a bath bomb or something.
Yeah.
Guys generally will take we'll take a shower. A woman might take a bath occasionally.
Maybe it was probably just the way he was raised.
He said, that's what he said. He said, that's how I was raised. And I said, but you've got a shower. He said, I use it to store empty glass and plastic bottles.
Like, you have some weird friends. All right, moving on. Oh, nice. I see what you did there.
All right. Up next, I just missed a question, but somebody, I deleted it and I'll think of it from memory. Somebody says they have one of those Fresnel or Fresnel lenses, and you can get it from a survival store.
Cool. Remember, if you're just tuning in, full moon tonight, pick up $15, get an infrared thermometer, and check out the moonlight tonight. And plus, again, it's not like you have to throw this thing away. This thing can be used for anything. You can check the temperature on anything, like my skin. All right.
You're alive? Stock jockey writes, Mark, in the early 80s, I went to Griffith's Observatory and had the opportunity to actually look through the telescope with the roof open. And as I was looking through the telescope, I saw Saturn in the rings. Do you have any thoughts? He says he's a flat earther now, and I know indeed stock jockey is.
Oh, yeah, yeah. And I joked, well, I didn't joke, I was serious. And that's anybody that, when this thing comes to light finally, anyone that worked for an observatory is out of a job, because it is no different than walking into a planetarium with a pair of binoculars. You see Jupiter up there, then you take your binoculars and you're looking at Jupiter in your binoculars. Does it help you? No, it does not. Yeah, does it look closer and more real? Yeah, I suppose, but you're in a planetarium, so you know it's fake. The difference is that we were always in a planetarium and we never knew it. So the observatories, that's what they are, just giant pairs of binoculars that are looking up at a really high advanced projection system, and they can't tell that it's a projection, because why would they? It's the last thing on their mind. So yeah, you saw the rings? Great, wonderful. The best pictures are from NASA, and you know full well they can be trusted.
Yeah, the best real pictures you can get is that P900 camera where Saturn's rings. You can just look up pictures of this if you want with the P900. Yeah. You'd have to look them up using flat earth as a tag keyword, but it just looks like a
blur
circle with a ring around it, and it looks solid. It just looks like it doesn't look like a sphere. It just looks like it's all one color as well. And Gregory May writes, I shower and rinse after the occasional bath. So I like our topics go all over the place.
Wow. New friends.
Eliza Sofa Spoons right. You're in our house, but it's cool. Welcome, peace and love. Don't really understand that, but peace and love, I'm all for it.
Word to Big Bird.
The YouTuber whose name is This Lana, L-A-N-A, writes, Lana would like this Mark Sargent and this Patricia Steere to comment about the strange phenomenon known as falling fish from the sky. Does this prove to us that there is water above the firmament, and are those fish falling through the windows of heaven? I've thought the same thing.
That's an excellent question. It's either...
The real explanation that they give us is that there's some kind of a atmospheric thing that happens where something scoops up fish from a body of water and then deposits them like a
giant spaceship.
Tornado. Well, like a tornado, Dorothy, Wizard of Oz style.
Oh yeah, whatever. No. It's probably something even more simple than that. You want to have some fun looking that up, because some people are going, what are you talking about? Fish falling from the sky? No, there's been a lot of really weird occurrences of ice and fish and frogs and weird stuff that has fallen from the sky. Look up the MK Jessup, JESSUP report on YouTube if you get a chance. It is a very, very interesting thing. And sorry, I had to close the window again. It's an interesting report that lists in great detail, and there was a lot more of these back in the past, especially in the 1800s in the United States, but all over the world. Look up some of these things. So yeah, it's very possible. Genesis 1:6, the waters above and the waters below. Could we, and Rob Skiba talked about this in one of his diagrams, could the ultimate container for this, the ultimate safeguard be that we're in a structure that's under the water? Very, very possible. Why not? Right. It's a great little mechanism, because if you actually were dumb enough to punch through it, Oh, there you go. There's your great flood all over again.
What a just so fascinating, all these different theories.
Yeah, agreed. Yeah.
Up next here on Q&A is from Brett Mallett, who writes, a quick question. I'm seeing a lot of information for the flat earth and the Mandela effect spiking for the same time period. Yes, indeed, me too. They seem to come around the same time. Is this part of them, the big they in quotes, wanting this to awaken all of us?
Yeah. Yeah, I do think so. And he's wrong. It's the Mandela effect.
Sorry, a little inside joke.
It is a little inside joke. You want to mess with somebody. Anyone ever tells you it's the Mandela effect, just make up something. The Mandelta effect? It's like, why did you say that? I don't know. I always thought it was the Mandelta effect. The what?
No, like, you know how it is with the Mandela effect. Look it up. Look, my old DVD and all of that.
My old DVD. Or you come back and say, you just told me this like 5 minutes ago.
Exactly. About even this? Who are you? I don't even know who you are. Stop talking to me. Get away from me.
Anyway, right. Yeah. Do I think they're using it to wake us up? Yeah, I think it's a big awakening. It's nothing's by accident. Not the big things. Really, do you think the world's most prominent astrophysicist is going to come on primetime television and not use any graphics or pictures and talk about, you know, say, oh, no, the Earth isn't flat? No, it's part of something bigger. We're being conditioned for something coming down the road. We'll see what it is. You know, it's going to be something big, whatever it is. You guys can take your bets. Somebody should get a pool going. What the setup event is going to be for.
We've got our next question here from Komorusan. I'm sure I'm saying that wrong.
He was like a brother to me.
It's flat earth is a catalyst to the end of deception on all fronts, including religion, evolution, modern science. It exposes all instruments of control for the purpose of discrediting our creator, all leading to the alien savior first contact agenda.
Well,
that sounds... You don't think so?
There was something I kind of joked about, which was because if you're from a technology sector, you're going to see it as an advanced race. If you're from the religious sector, and you know, that's the 80% of the world's population, you're going to see it as divine. And it was something I was kidded about, but you and I, you know where I'm going with this, which is out of the five major religions in the world, you know, each has its own weight. Basically, the first god that shows up wins. You know, if whoever shows up, all they have to do is say, perform a few miracles and say that, yeah, I'm the divine being that created this place, and everyone's going to buy it.
Yeah, but I think what they do, if they indeed do pull the alien agenda card, is going to say that an alien of some sort is going to say they created us. So it just knocks out God of every religion.
Well, unless they claim that, you know, if you built this place and you, you know, yeah, you land in a spaceship, wouldn't some people see them as God?
Yeah, that's
probably true. And then where do you go? And you got, you know, then you're, because some people will. Some people say, no, they're actually God. I mean, let's face it.
Well, science doesn't want religion to exist. So science getting behind an alien agenda and making an alien be our God and wiping out Judaism and Christianity and everything else.
Well, you're right. Got a good point.
Seems to be the case. I don't know. Morpheus Johnson writes, did you see the postings of the telescope in London that can see New York? It's fake, just a webcam, though people keep sharing it without even researching it. You two rock, by the way. Thanks, Morpheus. No, I haven't seen that fake posting, but I hate when things like that start spreading around. And it's, if you find something like that, just definitely make a comment on it saying fake, just so other people won't get fooled.
You know, the one that got me recently was the music from the other side of the moon. The astronauts apparently heard but didn't tell anybody until just recently.
Wait, how could you fall for that since you know we never went to the moon?
No, not me. No, didn't get me. No, the one that ticked me off more than anything. It was like, 'cause they're running stories. Somebody actually left me a message.
The stories in mainstream about science seem to be perpetuating the whole ball thing.
Now they seem to be doing multiple ones a day. And doing anything they can. Yeah, the gravitational wave thing. Oh, that was brilliant. Oh, yeah.
And there was a woman who graduated from college a few years, she's a few years younger than you, from Whitby Island, who supposedly is one of the scientists who was there witnessing the gravitational
waves. Got that? You got a copy of that?
Yes. Isn't that crazy?
Yeah, I actually got the real paper. I couldn't believe it.
Do you know
it.
If that person is a real person on Whitby Island?
Oh, no, they are. I'm actually a real... Well, there is a graduate from... You know, it's part of the team. She probably...
So, okay, does that mean that she's a liar and making stuff up, or how...
No. I'm sure she wasn't the one that initially gave him the hard data. She was just part of the research team that was working for the company. And there's a lot of people. It wasn't like just her and five or six others. There were hundreds of people working.
So it's like people who make satellites aren't responsible for pretending satellites are up in the sky. So she's just one of those people who's... wielding the hammer, let's just say.
Exactly. But yeah, she's just a wrench turner. But she graduated from my high school. Go figure. So yeah, when somebody sent it to me this morning, I was like, yeah, I know. That's why I'm hoping that the local paper will eventually, you know, talk to me down the road. And I don't know her though. She graduated years after I did. Mm-hmm. Younger. Young whippersnapper. Yeah.
Oh, there's the accent. That's the old country grandfather.
Right, country accent. Sitting on the front porch. So old man sitting on the front porch, and he says to his friend next to him, they're both in rocking chairs, you see. And he says,
this better be good, by the way.
It is. It's pretty good. Well, actually, it's called a groaner because it's really, by the time you get to it, it's like, oh, God, you probably heard it. It's like, you know, this hearing aid I got, it's the best hearing aid ever, top of the line, just wonderful hearing aid. And guy, he couldn't say enough about it. His friend goes, really? What kind is it? He goes, oh, about 4:15. Terrible, huh?
Oh, we need a drum roll.
Thank you. Tip your waitresses. They say you're supposed to know at least three clean jokes for mm-hmm. parties. That's
is that your one?
It's one of them, yeah. It's one of my. I won't tell you the other two because you guys, people at home are probably going, oh, God, help.
All right. Eliza writes, by the way, kudos with David Schrader on Darkness Radio, Mark. You did a great job and an even better show with Tim on there.
Tim?
Tim?
Okay.
Darkness Radio.
I'm sorry. Darkness Radio. Thank you. I was thinking Dark 30.
I'm getting them confused too. And then I even confused Dark City, the movie. Like,
yeah. Dark. You're right. Darkness Radio. That was a fun interview. Thank you very much.
Was good. Another statement is on Dark 30, the kid was a beep. He didn't sound like a scientist. He sounded like a punk.
So, he was older too. I think he was older than me, if I'm not
mistaken.
Yeah,
but it sounded like a kid to me too until I met the person.
Yeah, he had a higher pitched voice. And because he said he was in MUFON since like 71 or something like that. I was going, wait, how old are you?
And that's Mark, M-A-R-C, D'Antonio. I thought he was a kid too. He seemed like a frat boy type guy. And then I looked him up and he looked like generally about our age, give or take.
Yeah, he has no business coming up against Flat Earth at all. Honestly, I hope he went back to his hotel room, cried for about 2 or 3 hours, then emptied the minibar and then jumped off the balcony. That's really what I wanted to happen.
Into the swimming pool, so he's fine. He's okay.
Notice the laugh that she first gave you, though. Make no mistake, evil queen. Snow White, Sleeping Beauty, those women don't have anything on Patricia.
Orphan Red writes, hello, I watched a principal movie about geocentrism as truth, and I'm wondering if you think a crowdfunding project could be set up to do a movie like that about Flat Earth. Odd TV is well on its way, but we could organize movie theater screenings.
That's not bad, but eventually you're... Not bad, Orphan. Not bad. Not bad, Sasha, I should say. The problem there is that with the I just forgot the name of the movie.
The principal
Is that they talk to a lot of scientists, a lot of high profile people,
and they talk to celebrity people without letting them really know that this was about.
Yeah, there was even
than they were expecting.
The narrator, Kate Muldoon, is that her name?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
From Star Trek Voyager. She says she was ambushed, blah, blah, blah. Doesn't really matter. Flat Earth, we don't have enough high-profile people to talk to yet that have stepped forward. And really, honestly, this story is so big that by the time we get to that movie stage, who knows, maybe a producer will step in. But by the time we get to this movie stage where producers are thinking about it, there's already going to probably be television shows and radio things. And then it's going to
just become the new truth.
Yeah, it'll blow.
I mean, we know everything. It's the new truth, but it'll hopefully will become the new truth to everyone.
The difference between that movie and our movie is that our movie is here on the ground, so it affects everybody at once, and it the impact is way more definitive than theirs is. I mean, yeah, theirs is still talking about space and stuff like that, but ours really isn't. It's talking about the shape of the world. So, but it's not a bad idea. It's not bad. We'll see. We'll talk, Sasha. We'll talk.
And Eliza gives a sort of kudos to Orphan Red for coming up with that idea. Next question, it's more of a statement from DJ Sanez, who writes, tell Mark, thank you for sending us a copy of the video to Columbia. What video did you send to Columbia?
I must have sent an audio version because, what video did I send? it was probably Strange World. Because mobile devices, because of the Joe Jackson song I use, it's blocked in several countries.
You should just not use that song anymore so more people can watch the video. Well, not just, that I'm here to tell you what to do.
It's just blocked in Germany. It's not that big a deal.
German people deserve love, too.
And if they write me, I'll send them something. But I like the Joe Jackson song. It's part of the...
So do I. I love that song.
But it's not just that. That what they're also talking about is that YouTube, which you also didn't know, is if there's a song, it's different from video, and that is if there's a song that's used that Android doesn't want to pay for, because Android generally doesn't, then whatever video it's in, the Android device, not your iPhone, but the Android device won't play it. So it won't tell you why it's not going to play it, just won't play the video because of the music. But they won't tell you, even YouTube doesn't say, it just says it won't play on all mobile devices, because they don't know what mobile devices, even they don't know all the specific brands that are tied to it. iPhone pays for everything, so they're always going to see it.
Right, and I have an iPhone, so I can generally see everything. So.
There you go. And if you use a PC, you'll be able to see it. But I know that Android does have problems in other countries.
Got it. So. All right. Up next is this statement. I have well water and it's 700 feet deep and the water has a nice transparent blue tint to it. If we have water above the firmament, it could explain the blue skies during the day. Just a thought.
His water is actually blue?
A little bit of a blue tint. I've never seen anything like that.
You might want to have it tested.
It could be Windex.
Before you start drinking. I'm not saying...
I'm just saying that
distilled water, which has nothing in it, is clear.
Yes.
If your water is blue, actual blue...
Well, I think I know what he's meaning. He's meaning it's very clear, I guess. And it wouldn't be nice to have well water. I mean, your own well on your own property.
Yeah.
That'd be nice. David Weiss of Deep Inside the Rabbit Hole is asking a question, and I know he's poking fun at something, and I don't know what it is.
Why do we insist on talking?
He writes, do you know why round hay bales are illegal in most states? I know it's a joke, but I don't know what the joke is. So we'll move on from there, and maybe
he's going to send the punchline, isn't he?
I'm sure he will. Jimmy Roberts writes, I believe something big is going to happen and it might be the dome coming down because it says in the Bible, the stars will fall to earth at the end. What do you think?
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah. Several people I know, Controversy 7 and Celebrate Truth and Rob Skibit and a whole bunch of other people. If you're following the Bible literally, that is one of those very damning statements, which is the stars fall from the heaven, shaken from the heavens like figs from a tree.
Yes, and if the sun, the star, the size that it's supposed to be,
we'd
be like incinerated in like a second if that happened.
But if the stars were very, very small. Oh, which also reminds me, by the way, there was an interesting thing, and somebody caught it, I don't know if it was Odd TV or one of the other guys, where he put in that, the Vsauce video, the one Vsauce Flat Earth video that we've all watched, but I don't think I've watched the entire thing.
No, me either.
He actually took a clip from it, which was very interesting, where Vsauce says, is really the only useful clip out of it, where he said that, you know, when they were doing the whole sticks and sunlight thing, how the sticks and sunlight, you know, prove around Earth. But then Vsauce says, unless the sun was only about 30 miles wide and about 3,000 miles high, then the results would...
He says that
somebody put it in one of our flat earth things where, so he said, yeah, he goes, the sticks prove the round earth, the sticks and the sunlight measurement, unless the sun, but he said like it was ridiculous, right? It was like, unless the sun is only 30 miles across and 3,000 miles high,
elephants could fly.
unless that happens. And it's like, that's what we're saying. That's exactly what we're saying. The sun is only that big and it's only up so high. And so it was a great little clip. People, I'm pretty sure it's the end of Odd TV's latest video that he did on this.
I need to see it. I haven't seen it.
I'll send it to you. But it's pretty cool. It's like,
I love Odd TV.
So basically, you know, Vsauce is coming from the scientific standpoint, and if you could put that to a scientist and say, well, they, you know, they prove with, you know, shadows and sunlight that how it does this, it's like, well, yeah, but this also proves shadows and sunlight. If it's this, prove it one way or the other. And then they come back, well, the NASA thing, and then we start the whole snowball. Anyway, go on. What else you got?
Leap Out writes, is your temperature gun that you've got there, the laser, an AC temperature gun? If so, it measures air temperature.
Oh.
Is it?
No, I don't think so. It's the Laser Grip 1080 infrared thermometer.
Is this a lip balm break going on here?
It is a lip balm break. Sorry, I don't like chapped lips. I'm a big fan of never having chapped lips.
I think I've been told by people that the more you put stuff on like that, the more you become, your lips become addicted to it. Not literally addicted, but they will stop producing their own moisture.
I don't believe that, nor do I care. I only do it when I'm talking.
You need to lube up in order to speak.
Wow, really? You don't want to give those people that sort of ammunition. That's a meme waiting to happen. I don't know anything about this. I mean, it could measure air temperature at the target. I suppose I could dig up the manual and read it.
You're a guy. You don't read manuals.
But it seems to no, I do read manuals in this case.
You? Yeah. Most guys, I mean, I know it's sexist to say, they just know how something works and then just grab it and shove it together and bam.
Really?
Yeah. And meanwhile, I'm reading the whole manual. Yeah. And
why are women's feet smaller? So they can stand closer to the kitchen sink. Yeah.
No.
I totally don't mean that, by the way. I put women on an utter pedestal. Ask this one here. It may measure air temperature. I don't know. I don't think it's going to affect anything because if an object's out there in...
Yeah, like we said, the air temperature will be affecting the object that's in the air.
I don't think it would... Yeah, it's like, are we talking... Now he's going to start getting me confused. Are we talking about the air temperature here or the air temperature at the target? Because I think it's
probably be the same, right? Because it's not shooting miles away.
Okay. I mean, like, for example, I'm pointing at my arm and it's pushing about 90 degrees. Ultimate, you know, your normal temperature if you know, and it'd be raised once you get closer to your heart. But if it was actually measuring air temperature, then if I pointed it back here, mm-hmm. and I'm firing through and it's, what, 76 in this room? I'm still not going to, yeah, here's 89. I can't imagine. And like, if I point at that light, here's a perfect example. There's a light over there, right? And there's got to be 5-6 feet between me and the light. If I point at it, oh, geez. Yeah, 140, 130. It's kind of a globish light. So yeah, it's...
Why do you have a globish item in your house? Are you a globalist?
Get rid of all globish light. No, it's a cool light. I like that light.
All round things. Get rid of them. What? Okay, just joking,
All people quit sports that use round balls.
Get rid of all eyeglasses immediately and earrings that look like hoops. This Lana comes back, this L-A-N-A YouTuber writes, this Lana knows the color blue is the last color of the color spectrum to disappear. The deeper you dive underwater, the more colorblind you become. Blues are the last color to go. That goes back to Comorosian's statement about the well water being blue. And this Lana knows a lot of stuff.
Don't know what to tell you. I just know if I had a well on my property and I dug up blue water, I'd probably take it to a lab before I started mixing tea with it.
Robin Poe writes, do you think by the time Neil deGrasse Tyson agrees to debate Flat Earth will be so widely known, he'll be irrelevant?
Yes.
I don't think he'll ever agree to debate.
He'll never debate. He went on that the Sway show. The rapper named Sway, he went on that show, and I didn't even realize this, but it makes sense because I don't think we've ever seen it. He's never debated an opponent. He's never gone after anybody. It's all been him. So he's either talking to his physicist students, physicists in a group of people, but there's nobody against him. There's no opponent. Or he's solo. He's just giving speeches on stage. He's a figurehead. He's a frontman for a band. That's all he is. I mean, there's a lot of physicists out there, I'm sure, that resent him because he's not the smartest physicist in the world, nor does he even, nor is he even the smartest in his field. Let's be honest here, folks, and this is not being me racist in any way, shape, or form. The only reason you see him as much on camera is because he's really good on camera. That's it. Your average physicist is a real nerd, and he's a cross between Bill Cosby and Sinbad. and he knows some physics. You've got that sort of charisma.
He's got the humor. He's got the charisma. Yeah.
He could do stand-up comedy. In fact, it wouldn't even have to be.
An actor.
He's
an actor.
He could have done. He's got enough on-camera charisma that he could have done just about anything he wanted. So having him do physics, oh, that's perfect. I mean, that's the only guy I wasn't getting. If something ever happened to him, I don't know who you would put out in place of him. There is no. It's like the backup quarterback for, a Hall of Famer or something like. There's nobody to back him up. I'm not saying you should go. Anything should happen, Neil deGrasse Tyson. I'm not saying that in any way, shape, or form. But I'm just saying.
Josh Ketchum writes: have you guys ever considered the rings of Saturn? The rings are a flat plane. Could we very well be on a flat plane inside a globe, aka Saturn's rings? Possible?
On a flat plane inside a globe?
Well, people have theorized that we are on the whole flat.
Oh, yeah. In fact, there was a guy that made a video the other day. Yeah, there was a guy that even said that the curvature formula is obviously wrong.
Been posting everywhere.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, not 8 inches per mile squared. It's 3 inches per mile squared, which means that the planet we're on is several times, three times larger than what we think it is now. But
how do we know that's not true?
How do we know that's not true? Mm-hmm. Well, if that was the case, even three times larger, I don't think.
Light, I guess, right?
Well, if that was the case, then there's still a ring of ice around us. There's a huge amount of water in this section, and what? There's a whole other continent that completely seals us off. Maybe, but why stop at three? Plus, he's not thinking big enough or small enough in this case, which is he's still thinking too big. And that is because I've had other people say, couldn't it be that we're on a much bigger planet, like 20 times, 50 times, 100 times bigger? It's like, why does there have to be a planet at all? Why? You're only thinking planet because you're conditioned to think planet. There doesn't have to be a planet. It could just be a series of rooms. Remember, machines and computers, they like to think in squares. They don't think in spheres and circles. So it's just as likely in that case that, use the Rob Skiva model, which we're in some sort of dome circular surface that's inside a big box. Because that's how we would do it. If we were going to build it to try to fake, some ants out, some really smart ants, we'd start out with a soundstage and then build whatever it is inside that soundstage.
Interesting. Yeah.
Look at the science fiction story, Ascension. Check that series out if you get a chance. That's a perfect example.
All right. Sorry. A.E. Solonius says, he just writes the name of the YouTuber, Quasi-Luminous.
Oh, yes, Quasi-Luminous.
Quasi-Luminous, I've often thought that I'd like to interview, and I don't know if he'd agree to do it or not, or even if that's a good idea.
That would be a weird interview.
But then again, that might be interesting.
He is on a lot of... I joked about it. It's like I keep seeing him, envisioning him in his spare time making newspaper ransom notes out of newspaper block letters. And then when he's bored with that, putting a whole bunch of pictures on the wall and connecting them together with strings. He's old school.
He's like a crazy brilliant person. But then again, hey,
Interesting guy. His mind never shuts down. I don't know when he sleeps.
Martin Liedke writes of Flat Earth British. Thanks for the flatty, guys. It means a lot. I think we gave him the flatty for the nicest flat earther, nicest guy in flat earth, I think. Yeah. He writes, does Mark theorize the sun is made of plasma? If not, then what? And could he attempt a Welsh accent for fun? God bless you all in the flat earth. And he also says the flat earth could be like the film The Cube. A Welsh accent would be hard. I don't even know.
No, I have one. I am not that good at accents. I mean, I play around here and there, but I am not. I'm not that good. If he's talking about the Eric Dollard version of the sun, where the Eric, you look up Eric Dollard, where he's talking in a car and there's a lot of conviction in that guy's voice. He's going, look, nobody, you know, like the sun, where it gets its energy, there is no fusion. You only see fusion in the flares and the radiation in the flares. And he goes, nobody knows what's powering the sun. And that it seems like it's a transformer, like a light
bulb. Coming from where? He's like, I don't know where.
Well, that light bulb over there, where's that power coming from? You know, right. I know just because I'm in the room and I know the layout of the room, but if you didn't know the layout of our solar system, you wouldn't know where the light's coming from. Where's the energy coming from that the sun gets its energy? He suspects that, yeah, that the sun is literally just a light bulb.
Do we have a solar system? When we use that term, our solar system, do we have a solar system even?
No, really. Why would you? You don't.
Right. You just said from our solar system, and I'm like.
If you have the ability to create the illusion, it's power perceived as power achieved. If you have the ability to create the illusion, which everybody buys, that's what you go with. Because why build a solar system if you can fake it? If you can fake the planets and fake the stars and everybody's, oh, it's such a big, wonderful place and we're such a small speck in it. If everyone buys that, that's great. That's what you go with. It's way less maintenance. I'm saying this from the developing standpoint. Look, I'm not saying that God's lazy. I'm just saying that God's efficient. There's no need to build a solar system if you don't. It's a waste of space. To do it that way. Just pretend that it is. Tell people anything you want. Make up the distances. Make up the bodies. And so let science do the rest.
Well, thanks to Martin Liedtke for that question.
Thanks, Martin. Martin. By the way, I don't know him being the nicest guy. I think he killed like 3 people. I'm just saying.
Just to watch him die. He's going to be my guest Wednesday here on Flat Earth and Other Hot Potatoes at 5 p.m. Pacific time. And hopefully there won't be any technical difficulties because he's had a couple before with a computer crash. So fingers crossed on that one. Martin Liedtke, Flat Earth British, Wednesday, 5 p.m. right here. Same radio channel, same radio time.
Really? You're going to do the whole same bat time, same bat channel, and you just change it?
Change it to radio. It's not even radio. It's YouTube. HAMM3R writes, is CERN creating the Mandela effect when they are trying to break out? Some have theorized.
The Mandelta effect?
Exactly.
Yes. It's possible. They could be also trying to open a door. Or maybe they've already opened it. Maybe.
Okay. I'm skipping through some questions, trying to get some.
I don't even know what a Welsh accent is. And honestly, it's because people make fun, and I'm not going to make fun too much because that whole joke, it's like, you know, UK, you know, Scotland, Ireland, who cares, right? And it's all the same thing. It's like, here's Scotland, here's Ireland, here's the bloody sea. Now get the hell out of here, you know.
Well, Scottish and Irish love each other, but English and Scottish are not fans of each other, historically speaking, anyway.
Historically, they've had a few.
They've had their ups and downs. A little bit. All right, next
friction.
John Armstrong writes, hi, Patricia. Hi, Mark. Where did Mark get his shirt? Now, I know you referenced it early on, but where did it come from exactly?
It came from a listener.
I know, you have to look it up.
They sent me two shows. Yeah, it's from a previous thing. I don't remember the name of the person. I think it was down in Oregon. I can't remember, but they're nice shirts. This is the first time I've even washed this. This is the first time I've worn it. So I don't know. I don't know. It was from a listener. People send me things sometimes. And if you send me a shirt, I'm probably going to wear it unless it's completely out of place.
All right.
Not going to wear a shirt with boobs on it.
Ew. Let's hope
not. Or a big middle finger or a thing that says, I hate Welsh people.
Mark's camera's not working. What's going on here? That's what you said. It's technical difficulties. Yeah. Anyway, there's a guy whose name is Alistair Kane who has written me a letter, and he writes, clearly that's not my real name. My true full name, business address, and cell phone number are listed below. I won't mention what that is. And he said, it's mildly relieving to be able to share my true identity with someone. I do ask that you do not out me, so to speak. And he says, not because I'm afraid Masons will show up at my door and disembowel me, Alas, the truth is much more dull. He writes, I'm a pro ballroom dancer, studio owner, instructor, and many of my students have typed my name to Google just to see what comes up. Most, if not all, of my clientele is still asleep, and they're hardly willing to discuss how ridiculous the Coriolis effect is during a tango. And he writes, yes, I did try that once, and no, it didn't go over well. Anyway, Alistair Kane writes, anyhow, I'm unfortunately not in a position where I can afford to lose business over my beliefs and understanding of the world. Not yet, anyhow. I can say that I do admire your bravery for speaking openly about your beliefs and opinions, and long for a day when people aren't judged for asking questions that go against the paradigm. What I'm not concerned about is discussing Freemasonry with you, strange as that may sound. I figured I'd open up the lines of communication, and if you're interested in what I have to say or have any questions at all, you can let me know in your reply. He writes, so you're aware, I joined Smithstown Lodge number 1127 a few years back with the sole intention of getting to the truth. Yes, I did have daydreams of infiltrating the ranks and finding out the true secrets of the Illuminati. Sadly, that hasn't happened yet. In fact, the craziest thing I've seen thus far was the image of Baphomet on the flag during my Royal Archmason degree of the York Rite. However, after some time spent in the New York City Masonic Library, I learned that the Baphomet has to do with St. John the Baptist and nothing to do with Satan. Bummer, as I thought I was finally onto something. I'm sorry, I'm writing quite a bit and I don't even know if you're interested in hearing what I have to say. Let me know. Regards, Alistair Kane. An amusing little message.
I actually know who you're talking about. I know exactly what that is.
That's a cool guy.
Because there's not too many that are ballroom dance instructors.
Yes, yes. Yeah. And he's got other letters he's written, and I'll read them at another time. We don't want to make it the Alistair Kane show because he's got really fun stuff to read.
I should bring this up real quick, and that is because he mentioned that he was still technically in the Flat Earth Closet, which is fine. You know, you don't want to join the Pride Parade. That's totally fine. But... you know who I'm super proud of that not only is out of the closet, but she is freaking hitting the streets is Marmar.
Oh, Marmar just did a live presentation in front of a group of people. Yeah. And just
Different from walking in like
eloquently and just the way she always does in front of people.
We're not talking Darren Nesbitt style where people actually knew what they were getting into when they showed up. I mean, she hit a restaurant / club with this, you know, on the microphone, and JL Forbes, I think, was there to record it.
Yes, indeed.
And wow. Wow. She was, you know, talk about nerves of steel.
I think it's on JL Forbes' YouTube channel.
Yeah. Marmar didn't put it on hers. She probably should.
She might.
But it's, I'm thinking of mirroring it on mine, putting them together and mirroring it. It's really great. Again, she went up there, just hit it, you know.
And some people were tittering, laughing in the audience, but yeah. She just went on because she's speaking truth and just said, it was a beautiful thing to see.
Yeah. Yeah. It was really, really something. So very, very cool. Don't be in the Flat Earth Closet.
Come out and play with us.
Yeah, exactly.
We have a message from Bashar Al-Jud, who writes, hey, Patricia, it's been really nice watching YouTube videos. And I got to say, I'm a flat earther person, and you've restored my faith in God. And I do see the truth, thanks to you and Mark and others. I hope I live long enough to see this become bigger and bigger, because, you know, here we are threatened to die any second. Wish you all the good luck. Greetings from Syria.
Wow. Okay.
Well. Yeah, I mean, it sounds kind of funny, but yeah.
But again, that's part of the reason why I think this movement could change the world, and that is, if you all knew you were in a flat world where everyone was part of the same family, would you go to war? Would war even exist? If someone was looking over your shoulder, would you keep doing the same things you're doing?
Would you steal a parking spot from somebody? Would you throw trash out of the window of your car? Just even those little things.
Wow, good point. Because, if you're thinking about it and thinking, you know, you got that little devilish look in your eyes, like, that parking space is mine, then you're probably not going to.
Give a shout out to Vince White. He's trying to put together a Flat Earth comic. And he's appeared on
the Flat Earth comic book. Flat.
Yeah, yes, exactly. Cryptic Comics, Conspiracy, Paranormal, and The Fringe. And it's called Flat. And he is attempting to fund a project. He's trying to get backers up to do it, and he only needs $4,000 as his goal. I don't know where he is right now on this, but he appeared on Jaren's show and a couple other shows, and Where is this? Where can we fund him? Do you know off the top?
I do not know, unfortunately.
I copied all of this.
I just saw him for his first interview on a, you and I talked about where he was on a show that Rob Skiba was on recently. Mm-hmm. And he seems like a good guy. Yeah. So yeah, more any Flat Earth Media that's out there. And if we ever do anything, you know, bigger than what we're doing now, you know, by all means, there's going to be more Flat Earth stuff to you know, hawk your wares. If you have Flat Earth stuff, it gets the message out, makes you a little money.
It's a Kickstarter. It's a Kickstarter campaign.
Oh, cool.
So you can look up a Flat Earth comic by Vince White. Donate $5 if you've got it. If you want to help an artist in the Flat Earth world, wanted to give him a shout out. Got a couple other things.
By the way,
here.
That show that you did last night, what were you wearing? What was that silver outfit?
Oh, people, I was wearing
people it's were a, calling you Barbarella.
It did look very Barbarella-ish, the movie. And it also looked like a spacesuit, I guess, as well.
Yeah,
it was
like a spacesuit.
A knit silver metallic top.
Where does one acquire a knit silver metallic top?
From my magic closet, filled with all sorts of things.
Her closet is magic, along with a mirror on the wall.
Magic mirror on the wall. Yep, it's the Mandelta effect for sure.
The Mandela effect?
Brad writes, hello. I found where the Coriolis effect is mentioned on page 168 of the U.S. Navy SEAL sniper training program from 2011. The text states that it's debatable about how relevant the Coriolis effect is to sniper shooting. The author laughs it off by concluding this paragraph by stating, quote, I'm Irish, so I don't have to worry about any of this. I just get lucky.
Nice. And yeah, you're absolutely right. The sniper instructor that I read a statement from was United States Marine Corps, and he taught for 3 years, wasn't even in the manual. So it wouldn't surprise me if different manuals, if it's not a factor, then why bring it up? Who is that? I keep forgetting his name. There's a big YouTube channel called Learn Something Every Day, or, you know, that real energetic guy that does science experiments.
Yeah, and that's not his name, but it's close to that.
Yeah, I can't remember the name of the channel, but
getting smarter every day. That's not it either.
Getting smarter every day. Something like that. Smarter every day.
That's it.
Woo-hoo. Smarter every day. Well, he did a Coriolis effect test. Basically, he was saying with the toilets and the sinks and everything, it was absolutely inconclusive because he had a friend down in the Southern Hemisphere. So they synced up a thing to where they did it the exact same time, the exact same day, where they set up a kiddie pool with a drain in the center. And just to make sure there were no ripples or anything, they used an eyedropper with food coloring. And then hit the plug on the drain to make sure, you know, to see how the water drained down the hole. And it was almost non-existent. I mean, yeah, you could barely tell it was there, you know, and they said, oh yeah, here it is kind of one way and here is the other way. But it wasn't nearly the force that they thought it was even going to be. So yeah, the ballistic tests and all the people that have testified for me, you know, the missile guy and the submarine guy and the artillery guys, they all say the same thing. There is no Coriolis effect. But mainstream science will say that it's there. That and why airplanes don't use it. You know, the whole thing there.
I just wanted to have a little cat sighting here.
Cat sighting.
This is Flynn, who has jumped up on my chair. Jumped up on my lap. But come on, Flynn, show your face. Oh, well, he's not.
That's because your dress is confusing, Flynn.
It's confusing.
The flowers on your dress is confusing the target.
He wants to attack me, not the flower. So that concludes another show, I guess.
Yeah, I've got
a bunch more Q&As, but
sorry, unfortunately, I've got to get. Well, one, I got to do my test because I'm going to be on the Z Talk Radio tonight. Nice. I'm going to do the Buzz show, and then after.
So wait, can I listen to that live somewhere?
Yeah. Go to Z Talk Radio. You should be. I'll see if I can give you the description so you can put.
Can you send me a link after, and then I will put it in the description of this video, and I will also put it on my Facebook and Twitter.
I'll be doing that, and then after that, literally as soon as that show ends, I'm jumping over to Jaren and Mrs. show on True Frequency Radio.
Wait, back to back today?
Yeah. So I'm doing a triple today, which is super fun.
Triple threat.
Yeah. And then then I've got one tomorrow, and then my show tomorrow, and then two on Thursday. It's busy. It's getting a lot busier.
10 p.m. Central tomorrow, the 23rd of February, 2016. It's Jeffrey Grupp. And the following day is Wednesday at 5 p.m. Central. It's Martin Lee, Key of Flat Earth British. That's my...
So you're really busy too. So well, yeah, the big competition. Who's going to do more? Am I going to do more interviews or are you going to do more shows? Because right now we're within what, one of each other? Because this is show 64 for you.
The thing people need to do is do what we're doing. Make more videos.
Just make more videos. Just get the word out there.
Yeah, it's a great
Join the fight. Change the world.
All right. Thanks, Mark, for doing it. It's been fun.
It has.
Episode 64 comes to its conclusion. And I don't know, can you say keep it flat in an accent? Maybe the Russian accent in honor of Croatian girl, our daughter.
If our daughter is listening, keep it flat.
Yes, keep it flat.